the Starbucks Workers Union.
Workers could self-organize, and in fact, the most prominent union buster in the country was caught on a conference call, and it was leaked. Richard Berman, and he said, you know, there's a problem. There's this new thing where workers are not going to wait for a union to come to them. They're going to start their own union. And he actually called it the Starbucks problem after our campaign.
The interview partners were from two ways of the Starbucks Workers Union. In this respect, the model represents a summary of the composition of May 2003 to June 2006 and August 2012 to April 2014. However, both models are connected in that they build on the experiences made from the further generation. This applies both to the side of the companies that link their anti-union activities with each other and to the side of the fellow workers who worked with each other in sharing their experiences. The primary basis. The Starbucks Workers Union is mainly based on the baristas, the workers who make the coffee. The reason for this focus lies in the principles of the IWW to be a self-organized grassroots union of workers. In the worldwide statutes of the IWW, it says that workers who have the power to hire or fire someone else cannot be part of the IWW. They are accordingly excluded from the sections and projects of the IWW. In addition, as allies, they are activists of the labor movement, journalists, and also cases before the National Labor Relations Board. The secondary basis. The main adversary was the Starbucks management, as they are the main actors in shaping working conditions. The three biggest problems. In both waves of the SWU, the following problems were named as the three top problems. First, the uncertain number of working hours.
If financially, if you knew your schedule was just going to be okay, like I get 20 hours a week and I work Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, that would be okay. But you don't have that power to like say that's when you want it. So you can't get another job on the side, or it made it, at least at my, in my particular location, made it very difficult to like try to have a second job on the side. I think if you were like a student, you could set your schedule a little bit and be like, okay, I can't come because I'm in school, that kind of thing. But that, you know, it just makes your life really, really stressful.
In connection with the uncertainty of numbers of working hours, the interviewers also reported the problem that they only learned very briefly when they would have to work at all. They argued that they could hardly plan their everyday life in the long term. At the Jimmy John's Workers Union and the Burgerville Workers Union, insecure working hours were also among the most important problems, according to a colleague, an overarching trend in sectors with a high share of low wages. Number 2. Disrespect for workers. It is manifested in high demands in the workplace with simultaneous dismissals for small mistakes by workers.
It was how. They fired who they could fire. You know, people who weren't watching their shit as closely as they should would do something wrong. They would fire them immediately. They pushed people a lot and like made ridiculous demands so that way, you know, bad schedules and work late or not enough staffing and people would transfer.
Number 3, a missing organized voice. Particularly in matters of affecting the entire workforce, fellow workers lacked an organized voice that could have negotiated with management. The lack of this voice led to the problem of not being able to negotiate with the employer on a larger scale.
The wage was also low, and there was just fundamentally no voice, whatever the issue. For example, when they informed us that, you know, very small percentage of their coffee is fair trade, but we're obligated to say, if a customer asks, all of the coffee is fairly traded. They pushed us to do that after barista started raising awareness around the coffee farmer conditions. So voice was a big piece.
The three problems mentioned above were most often tackled collectively, as they were considered the most urgent problems in everyday life. Two other points were also mentioned. on the one hand, low pay, and on the other hand, sexual harassment, which was expressed mainly by female fellow workers. Top three advantages of membership. These included, number one, the ability to challenge unfair management, improved working hours for better planning of life, that is number two, and number three, a supportive community through solidarity that cancels out its isolation. Also mentioned were a small financial support and the hope for organizing in a better form. The unique selling proposition. A simple, clear message that explains why we are different and why it is worthwhile to participate. The unique selling proposition, expressed in a slogan, was "Together we win," which refers to the collectivity with which the SWU works. The strategies. Where do fights take place? How do we win? As strategies, the fellow workers named the establishment of committees at the store level to carry out direct actions inside and outside the stores. The importance of the media in relation to the vulnerability of the company was also discussed. For example, their assertion that all workers had health insurance or that every coffee was fairly traded, the company had to be challenged. In publications, petitions and events, these things were criticized and the difference between the company's public relations and reality was revealed. In addition, major lawsuits have been used as power levers against Starbucks to improve working conditions for many and to secure them in the longer term. Relations with customers were also addressed. They varied from store to store and were in part helpful in a workplace such as the catering trade because some customers had good relations with the workers and supported them in their concerns. In addition, there are also relationships along the industry, for example, through one of the interview partners' tour to coffee farmers in Ethiopia, which corresponds to the vision of organizing along the value chain in order to improve the conditions of many and increase the power of the workers. The competitive advantage cannot simply be fought by an enemy actor or opponent. One of the competitive advantages of their own organization, which cannot be fought by an opponent or hostile actor, was their model with few resources. Their financial resources could not be scarce, as it can happen with other large organizations. In addition, there was a clear voice from the baristas themselves, which was expressed in the fact that they organized their union themselves and were not led by full-time staff. This increases both the decision-making capacity and the strengthening of democratic procedures. A third competitive advantage is the open opportunity to participate. Since the entry threshold was low and the development of one's own activity uncomplicated. It was also said that at the time in the United States no one else was organizing in the field of system catering, as well as that they had many activists from the community to support them. As a result of these circumstances, they were able and needed to try out many things for themselves, as there were few role models. Perhaps the relatively high level of support from activists can also be explained by the pioneering effect. The costs, long-term and short-term financing. In principle, the SWU had no financing. There was a small share of membership fees from the SWU and the IWW. This difference came about through the formal separation. There was also a small amount of donations. In the second wave, there was also a fund for fired fellow workers. The low financial support made the fellow workers creative in financing leaflets, homepage, etc., but also meant that there was no great financial dependence. The key indicators. In the Worker Association Canvas, the key performance indicators stand for the success criteria to a certain extent. For the Starbucks Workers Union, this was the number of stores where the Starbucks Workers Union went public, the number of cities where campaigns were active, the number of dues-paying members, and the number of issues that were handled. According to fellow workers, the number of these individual factors also increased the power of the union. The channels, ways to reach members, allies, and the rest of the base. The Starbucks Workers Union's channels were mainly communication among workers through the one-on-one interviews, Facebook, SMS, and WhatsApp. In addition, there was its homepage, StarbucksUnion.org, as well as the IWW local groups and the Starbucks Workers Union's own media, such as the newsletter. In the end, it was media formats that were easily accessible and could be used by as many workers as possible. The core competencies. Three things we have to be world-class in. Here, innovative thinking, number one, was mentioned above all, which consisted in building up organization at all in the field of system gastronomy and being able to adapt strategies and forms of action as required. The persistence, number two, with which the fellow workers organized, there was named second. They could not even be stopped by the largest union-busting company in the United States from continuing to organize. Basic organization, that's number three, took place both locally and through national networks and international networks such as International Work Association. A further strength was the media work of the Starbucks Workers Union, that's number four, which was captivating with many articles and, among other things, intensified actions in shops several times and led to nationwide wage increases, since the company was relatively vulnerable due to its strongly presented corporate philosophy if contradictions could be proven publicly. Membership and multiplier structure. How do we define membership? How are decisions made? What criteria define membership? What is the structure? The definition of membership has changed time and again. In the beginning, workers would be member of the campaign or the Starbucks Workers Union. Later, fellow workers were asked to become members of the IWW. The special thing about the Starbucks Workers Union model is that there was a separation between the IWW and the Starbucks Workers Union. The core of organizers were initially members of the IWW, and only in the course of time did they also become members of the SWU. But it was possible to be a member of the Starbucks Workers Union without being a member of the IWW. This had the advantage that the formal hurdle of signing a paper, committing to the revolutionary aims, and paying a monthly membership fee was removed. This regulation changed several times over the years. The language rule, however, was always the Starbucks Workers Union is affiliated with the IWW. At the local level in New York City, there were weekly or monthly meetings. Decisions were made by a majority. Leaders could potentially be anybody, and there were committees for different tasks from individual stores to a campaign level. For example, there were committees for legal issues, media, and merchandising. The mechanisms. How are the conditions improved, improvements maintained? How are members kept? How are the successes bound to being a member? The concept of the mechanism was not known to the fellow workers at the beginning. The focus here is on the question of how improvements, once achieved, can be maintained in the long term. One form was to punish the company for behavior, such as deliberate intimidation or spreading fear among fellow workers, so that the Starbucks Workers Union would take action. Members were also retained through affinity and content. One could describe this as an extension of the conviction in terms of ideology. In addition, there was the social support by the community for members, as well as the national and international networks of the IWW. The new category, attack techniques, the management splitting techniques. The interviews made it clear that one category was missing from the canvas. What are the attack or splitting techniques of management? Trade unions are, to a large extent, always reactive organizations and must defend themselves against management techniques and in their current manifestations as they represent the framework for collective action. In order to reconstruct the dimensions of meaning of these techniques and to make them accessible as one of the conditions for extending capacity to act, it is necessary to address them during the organizing process. This was discussed in the interviews. In the case of the Starbucks Workers Union, this was the schedule system, which occurred in a combination of insecurity for the workers as well as repression for non-conformist workers. Since 2011, This has been further refined and radicalized in favor of the corporate side by their new software. Among the social techniques used by Starbucks, several conclusions can be drawn from the interview material. These include the low-wage policy with its temporary contracts, the schedule that are only passed on to fellow workers on a short-term basis, and the correspondingly poor planning ability with regard to both one's own free time and the planning of other jobs. Starbucks is one of the pioneers in this area.
The schedule was a really big one. I mean, we all had it, still a problem today in many industries, especially low-wage industries. Everybody was part-time, 100% part-time workforce in terms of rank-and-file workers, and the hours were extremely unpredictable. You could neither predict how many hours you'd get, nor could you predict when they would be scheduled. So it was very difficult to take on a second job, very difficult for single parents to arrange, or any parent to arrange for childcare. And it was difficult to balance in, you know, some people were in school, etc.
These divisions, which were also enforced by means of computer technology, were also evident at the level of the composition of the corporation of fellow workers and the schedule of workers. Who works with whom was both ordered accordingly to demographic groups and also consisted in the separation of the unionized and the unorganized.
I think the scheduling was very much about applying just-in-time inventory to labor. I think that was Starbucks was really a pioneer there. Now it's used by everybody, but they were a real leader in turning employment into the computer rolls the dice for you and you get your schedule and you're in, you're out, depending on their forecast of demand and depending on the ratios of labor hours to sales that they believe in for Wall Street. There's techniques. I mean, there's a lot of propaganda from day one around the company, around its mission. There is definitely shift lead roles and shift supervisor roles, which in some cases could be used to divide. Sometimes that was effective, sometimes it wasn't. Definitely once the union started, they became much more conscious of who was scheduled with whom, who was in what store, for sure.
When asked what difference it makes to work in a workplace that is heavily public, one worker describes how it was far more difficult for a boss to shout at individual workers and increase pressure. Instead, bosses tried to isolate workers in warehouses or back rooms.
He knew there was nothing he could say out there because every single one of them, we knew their drinks, we knew their lives, we knew their children, like everything, and they loved us. So, I don't know. I mean, the harassment would happen more in private in the back, you know, and when they pick us off one by one and not in front of anyone on the line, not in front of the customers, because I think that was our strongest place.
The techniques described here can be found in various fields of gastronomy and retail. In the following part, some of the successes and failures of the Starbucks Workers Union are shown and illustrated. Part B, successes and failures of the Starbucks Workers Union. The aim of IWW campaigns is the immediate improvement of working conditions and the development of skills of involved workers in order to create a world based on needs in the long run. Criteria for success is the improvement of the conditions of struggle and living and the training of organizers. It could also be formulated in the language of critical psychology that the goal of the IWW is a generalized capacity to act and campaigns must be measured by whether they have done so. The difficulty is to operationalize this, but at least successes and defeats can be presented. One of the central points identified by fellow workers in the discussions was the relevance of worker-led trade unions, which gave workers a voice. This is relatively unusual for trade union models that often rely on the support of full-time workers and the level of activity of the workforce falls or rises as a result.
The fact that it's worker-led and operated, the fact that it was really rooted in workers organizing. You know, there's never a time where we said, well, you know, we'll just become a corporate accountability type of group. I mean, I think that's fantastic.
The Starbucks Workers Union had a relatively large media echo, which is reflected in many articles and YouTube videos. Several wage increases at national level were pushed through, as well as guaranteed working hours for union members.
One thing we were able to do was I got contacted by the New York Times when they had, maybe it was the Wall Street Journal, when they had the piece about the woman in LA, just like a single mom, and she was like working these shitty Starbucks schedules and couldn't make ends meet, and it was like this super tearjerker. So I provided a lot of the background research and then gave her contacts of my members to validate her piece and show that it was systemic. So that got us a dollar raise and two, like nationally, and 2 weeks notice on schedules. So that was huge. And then we also would call, you know, they'd call the check back in. Hey, are they actually given 2 weeks? No, they're not. Like, and pull in another piece, you know, and bring that to light. So that was really good.
On the negative side, the organizational structure of both the IWW and the SWU were not very mature, so that the membership definitions changed several times. This is due to the factor that in sectors with high fluctuation, there was little previous experience with trade union models. In addition, there was the low level of documentation, which is a fundamental problem, since even in mainstream unions, for example, often only minutes or speeches are handed down rather than written backups of the actual knowledge of the members. Even though there is relatively much material available compared to other IWW campaigns, it is still difficult to document what exactly happened in the Starbucks Workers Union. Even the website of the Starbucks Workers Union, which served as the most important source of information, in this respect, it is also difficult to determine how many fellow workers have actually been involved, participated in campaigns, and possibly continued to organize in other organizations or companies over the years since 2004. This should not necessarily be treated as an organizational problem, but also corresponds to the logic of social movements with their flaring up and ebbing of movement cycles. To a larger extent, it is unknown where the organizers are working today, whether they are still active in the IWW or perhaps in other unions. To what extent this organizing has changed? Only by interviewing more organizers could it be determined whether the breakdown of living and action conditions in the organizing process has also led to a changed practice in other jobs or areas of life. In connection with the Starbucks Workers Union, and also with the history of the IWW of the last 20 years, it can be seen very clearly that the actions at Starbucks have created a worldwide glimmer of hope, especially for grassroots unions, but also for other unions. This is due to the fact that globally operating companies often radiate an aura of invulnerability. A worker from the Starbucks Workers Union on this.
I mean, ultimately, I think the most important legacy of the Starbucks Workers Union is that it showed that workers themselves could rise up and contend with one of these big brand companies, and that fast food workers were not just a bunch of kids who needed beer money, but were family people as well. That aura of invincibility that the big brands, retail and fast food brands had, that was done away with by the Starbucks Workers Union. And, you know, many observed and were inspired by the campaign. So it's really heartening to see the legacy continue in different forms.
This glimmer of hope also had an impact on the other trade union models examined here. Ultimately, the Starbucks Workers Union can also be described as a building block of a paradigm shift within the IWW, in which many fellow workers took themselves as a model to become active in the workplaces themselves.